In this video, I'm going to explain how to use the Sequins app in the Ornament and Crime module. There are quite a number of applications available for it, including an alternative firmware. But in this video, I'm going to focus in on this Sequins application. This is a dual sequencer, arpeggiator, envelope generator, and quantizer. If you watched any of my videos, you're going to see this come up over and over again, because it really is the melodic heart of all my patches. Okay, now let's start with a basic patch. We'll just use a sequencer to play a melody on the MCO through the ripples filter, a little bit of reverb, then into the audio interface. So let's get started. First, we need to have a clock. So I'll just take an output here from PAMS. We're going to trigger one. Then we're going to take the output of the sequencer, just the CV value, into the volt per octave input on MCO. Take the output of that, the audio output of that, into the input of ripples. Now we'll take the low pass gate plus VCA and ripples into the filter. Ripples is nice in that it's both a filter and it has a VCA, so we'll be able to gate the output of the oscillator, which is always on, using an envelope we can generate here on the sequencer. And now you can hear the output of the oscillator there. So now we know we have our audio set up. Let's just patch a gate into the gain envelope input there on ripples. And now when we go into the sequencer, in this case, I'm using sequence 2, a simple 4-note sequence. Let's start playing it. That's pretty straightforward. Each of the notes are set relative to the tuning for the overall sequencer. So in this case, we're one octave below C. It's in the key of the root note is C. And because of the scale setting, we can change that. So if it's on Dorian, there you see Lydian has a slightly different set of notes are played. Locrian. You can choose whichever scale you like, and you can also define your own scales on the Ornament and Crime. Let's look very briefly at the basic operations of the sequencer. First of all, there are two sequencers. There's A and B, and they can each run independently. You use the right knob to navigate to the menu and to navigate into the sequencer. The left knob choose between sequencer A and sequencer B. And the right knob scrolls up and down, and a press will allow you to make an edit. So if I want to choose which sequence is playing, for example, I can rotate the knob. There are four sequences you can have in each sequencer. They can be playing independently from each other. And each sequencer can play either a sequence and then switch to another one, or just stay playing the same sequence of notes over and over again. When you define a sequence of notes, you can set any length. So here you see the last square indicates the length of the sequence. This is an 8-step sequence. I can navigate through my sequences while they're playing and edit them. The one with the little hash symbol in front of it is the currently playing sequence. I can edit sequence steps by just scrolling along with the left button, and the right button adjusts the relative height of the bars, indicating how many semitones over the root note that sequence step will output here on this CV output. If you want it to be a rest step to output nothing, just press the button, press it again to reset it back. If you had a previously defined value there, you press the button, it shows a hollowed out rectangle, press the button, and it turns back into an active step. If you want to adjust the length of the sequence, just navigate your cursor to the end square and then turn the right knob to adjust the length of the sequence to whatever you desire. You can do this while the sequence is playing. Take a listen. Here I'm adjusting the length. Now watch what happens when I adjust this. So you can see you can experiment with sequences as they're playing to find what works for you. Press the right knob, to go back to the main menu, the left knob to choose sequencer B, and then you can go down and adjust and edit the same sequences in the same way. One of the things you can do with the sequencer is, of course, change what direction it plays. It could go forwards, it can go backwards, it can go back and forth. So let's take a look at pendulum mode. You can see it going back and forth here on the screen. Or you can change that to be pendulum mode 2, where the last note is repeated. In this case, I think pendulum mode 1 sounds a bit better. Now, say you wanted the sequencer to run slightly faster than the clock was coming in. So this is a pretty fast clock right now. Let's say I wanted to slow it down. I can turn it to minus 2 division. Minus 3. Or I can go the other direction. Now, one thing I've noticed is when you stop the incoming clock here and you have your multiplier set to anything other than multiplied by 1, sequencer keeps running. So you just, if you see that happening, go in there and turn that back to regular, just times 1, and then the sequencer will stop when the incoming clock stops. Let's look at a few other sequencer tricks. We can also switch the play mode to arp. This will arpeggiate the sequence. And now you can hear the notes rising as the arpeggiator plays up. That's going over a 2-octave range. We can go down. Up and down. And random. And of course you can increase the range of octaves that the arpeggiator runs over. And you can apply the multiplier here again. What's generating the gate output here? So there are 4 outputs. 2 of them are the output of each sequencer. You've got sequencer A, and use left knob here to switch to sequencer B. Each of those 2 sequencers, A and B, are running in parallel, and they can each be playing 1 of 4 different sequences. Now we'll cover in a few moments how you can use these CV inputs to select which sequence gets played, so you can either choose between them randomly or move between them in a more programmatic way. Each of these sequences can be different lengths, so this one is a 4-note sequence. If you just move this little index cursor to the end of the sequence and turn the right knob, you can increase the length of the sequence. Or you can decrease the length. If you want to set a step to be a rest, press this button. You'll see it gets hollowed out, if you will, if you just see there. And you can hear that that's now a rest and there's no gate generated. Press it again and it comes back. If we didn't generate a gate, the oscillator would be playing constantly through the filter. So we can go down to the auxiliary mode and we can change what the auxiliary mode does. The auxiliary mode creates 2 additional outputs here on the C and D outputs of the Ornament and Crime. You can use the auxiliary mode, for example, just to generate a simple on-off gate. And a copy of what is being output here can be output there, so you can effectively mult it. You can generate an attack decay, attack decay release envelope, or an attack decay sustain release envelope, the classic 4-stage envelope. And of course, everything about these envelopes is configurable here in the menu. So we can set the attack duration. So say we wanted a very sharp attack like this one, make that a very small number. Say you wanted it to be a slower note. Now you hear it changing in tone or changing in envelope as the envelope is much slower to start. Let's turn that back to about 35. I like it as that plucky. You can change it. Exponential shape envelopes, linear, old sign. I mean, you have a whole load of choices here. Probably more than you need just to get started. Similarly, you can set the decay, the sustain duration, the level of the sustain. In other words, when we get to that sustain part of the classic ADSR envelope, How loud is the note going to be? Turning it up. And now I'm turning it way down. So you barely hear the note being sustained. And finally, we can change the release, how long it takes for the note to release on the envelope. A very short release, shorter envelope. Longer release, a bit of a longer envelope. Okay, so we've seen how to create a basic melody. Now let's use the second sequencer as a sample and hold source, which we can then use to modulate things going on our oscillator and in our filter. So we've got one sequencer currently used, sequencer A, is being used to generate our melody. And here I've just gone down an octave, just gone down to octave zero, and switched to the pulse output on the MCO, because we're going to have some fun with pulse width modulation and wave shaping. If we play this melody, we can have a big change in the tone by just turning the filter. Let's automate that filter turning by modulating the frequency cutoff here using the envelope output of the second oscillator. So we'll pop over here to the second oscillator. Now right now it's just set to play in pendulum mode, so it'll go back and forth. So we'll just take and that's kind of a nice squelchy sound. We have a bit of an acid sound going on here. This is just an attack decay envelope. With a pretty quick attack, we can actually make that a little longer. Let's speed that up. Now we've got an envelope going on there. We can also modulate using the output of the second sequencer. And sure, let's take the sub output. Dial it into here. Really dirty up the sound. The CV inputs can be used in the sequencer to change all of these parameters which we've previously been adjusting manually. This means that things which you might have difficulty doing when you're playing other parts of your patch can now be automated. Let's take a look at how we can use the CV inputs to control how the sequencer behaves. First of all, press the right or down button, depending on the type of ornament and crime you have, to get to the CV mapping page. I'm going to map the sequence number, this parameter here, to CV input 1. What does that mean? It means the sequence that we're playing, whether it's number 1, 2, 3, or 4, for sequencer A, will be selected using whatever CV value is at this input. So we can actually change which sequence is playing as the patch is going, depending on what the input is. And I'll just take a random sample and hold value from Pam's new workout here. So I just go in here, press this button to go into the CV mapping page, and I select CV1. So now the sequence number being played is selected using CV1. I'll just patch. This is a slow moving sample and hold into CV input 1. So as you could see, the sequence being played, not very musically, was being changed by the value coming out of Pam's new workout here into the CV value. You saw the different sequences, the length changing there. I set them up with different lengths, so we would see on the screen what was going on. By using the CV inputs, though, you can randomize things. Let's use it to transpose what's going on. We'll keep the sequence mapping the way it was, and we'll also go to the root note. Let's map the root note to CV2. We'll patch in from here on PAMS to CV input 2. So I have set the output here, number 3 on PAMS to go into CV input 2 on the ornament and crime, which I've now mapped to be the root note changing. So let's take a listen. As you can hear, that's not really very musical. You could play around with the settings here. I could probably quantize this and quantize that to a different scale and get something a little bit more musical. But you get the idea. Using the CV mappings, you can change any of the parameters on the sequencer. The length of the sequence is being played, which sequence is being played, the order they're being played. All of those things can be changed under control of other parts of your patch. It's a very powerful feature. One of the things the sequencer will do is continue playing from the last position it was at when you hit stop. So you see here the play dot is under the third step. If I hit play, the playhead starts from where it was previously. Now maybe that's the behavior you want out of your sequence, but most of the time you want the sequencer to start on the first step. So how do you do that? Well, to do this, you set a reset input into the sequencer. First of all, I've configured output 4 here on PAMS to just be a one-off trigger that gets generated whenever the sequencer clock starts running on PAMS. I'm going to patch that into trigger input 2. Then on sequencer A, which is the sequencer we're using for the melody, I'm going to scroll down to the very bottom here. The very bottom of the list is where the reset and clock inputs are defined. I'm going to set the reset mute input here to be reset 2. So when there's a trigger comes in on input 2, this will reset the sequencer. Now let's go back up into our sequencer. See how the playhead is on step number 5 right now? Watch what happens when I press play. Now every time I press play, the sequencer is reset to the first step and the melody starts from the beginning, which is usually what you want to have happening when you start a sequencer. Thanks for watching the video. I hope you found it useful. Please let me know what you thought in the comment section down below. And if you liked the video, hit like, and don't forget to subscribe for more videos in the future.